Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the public forum of the group exhibit Hydrogen Fuel Cells and Batteries. We are continuing our program here with the topic on the road to an emission-free Rhein-Main area, and this is going to be very interesting. And I would like to invite you all to sit down, have a drink on the house, and discuss with us with Professor Dr. Birgit Scheppert. She will be here. She's right there. She is member of the board of the Wasserstoff- und Brennstoffzelleninitiative Hessen e.V. So, Professor Scheppert, good to have you here. Welcome on stage.
Thank you. Thank you for being here.
On the road to an emission-free Rhein-Main area. Well, that sounds very ambitious. You know, Rhein-Main area, that's the area in the middle of Germany, we could say in the middle of Europe. A lot of main highways meet there, big cities like Frankfurt, Wiesbaden, and Mainz, and with a lot of industry and Germany's biggest airport. This area really becomes emission-free. You believe in that?
Not today, not tomorrow, but the day after tomorrow, we need to have a emission-free
Rhein-Main. It will be Saturday then, yeah.
Saturday, you're right. You see, we are not talking, as you already said, about a small number of vehicles. We are talking about a large number of vehicles. And to reduce the emissions and the noise, also the noise, that is an essential point. And how to do this? So we have to find solutions, and I think we have to think out of the box. At the moment, we have the persons who are saying in cities we have only to get rid of the diesel cars and the other cars, and then we will get just nice little car sharing models and so on. But on the long run, you have to think about the infrastructure, and you have to find out the best solution. And as far as I see it in the moment, we need to have not one solution, we have several solutions who work and are complementary in the end.
I really have to say I like the discussion about the diesel cars getting out of our inner cities, because people become creative at the moment. You know, we think about public transport for free. We think about new ways to share mobility. There's a lot of things in a pipeline through that. So does it help the discussion to emission-free, doesn't it?
I think it helps, but what we need in the end are clear regulations. We need strong regulation, which are telling us we have to bring out the lorries and the trucks. We have already some cities where the trucks are not allowed, like Rüsselsheim, where I'm coming from. Trucks are not allowed to pass through the city, except when they have a place where a hub, you know, the discussion of hubs. So, but you have to have in mind all the traffic when you're going in a German autobahn or when you're going to the cities in the morning. You see how many trucks and lorries going in here. How can we bring the things to the people? And when you are talking to my students, they always say, I don't need to have a car. I go by bike to the station, then I take a train. But this kind of mobility is not really well well planned, and just to bring in now our new technologies to say we have here electric cars, and we have it doesn't matter if the electric cars are battery driven or hydrogen driven. My feeling is for small cars we will have batteries, but for all other things we need hydrogen, and in meantime between maybe compressed natural gas, other things, synthetic fuels to reduce the load. But in the end, I think we will drive electric.
Professor Scheppert, but you said what we need is regulation. I have one proposal from Dr. Möllmann. I just heard it. I like that one. He said, if there's not 10,000 fuel cell cars by 2020 from German manufacturers, we're going to talk differently about this. Would you support that?
I agree on that. Because
it's impossible, but you would agree on that.
It's a vision, but we need to have cars, and we need to have buses in the cities. As far as my feeling is, you see, we drove the Coralind, the fuel cell driven train, and it was a very, very nice experience, because it's a quiet thing, it's very efficient. To be honest, we are talking about the city of Wiesbaden. Wiesbaden will be the first city in Germany who will be get rid of all their diesel buses and will have hydrogen buses and will have electric buses. And I can tell you, there are, if you are not talking about the bus for the mayor and the bus for publicity, when you are really talking about numbers of buses bringing into the city, then the infrastructure is a real critical issue.
And buses are very good because they are fleets. They only need one point to recharge. So a bus fleet in Wiesbaden. This is a project which is just going on, isn't it?
Yeah, it started.
Fuel cell bus fleet.
Fuel cell bus fleet and electric bus fleet.
And both.
Both. Okay.
So many. Yeah. How many buses will that be in total?
We will start with 11 hydrogen fueled buses. And we will have, in the end, the plan is to have more than 200 electric-driven buses in Wiesbaden.
And so what refueling station will you use? Will you build up a new one at the operator's
yes,
center?
Yes, at the moment we are planning a hydrogen fuel station, and we are very lucky because we have two very big hydrogen sources in our area. We have the in Fraserv Höchst Park, where you already had a lot of hydrogen, it's byproduct hydrogen, and we have Energiepark Mainz. As you know, Energiepark Mainz is a 6 MW electrolytic power to plant station. And what is very nice, they already Linde and the Stadtwerke Mainz decided that the next 7 years this plant is running. So we will get a lot of green hydrogen out of this plant for the 11 buses. The 11 buses is a joint bus project between the Wiesbaden SW bus fleet company and the Mainzer Stadtwerke bus fleet, and we have still the traffic that is the Frankfurt bus fleet operator. So they join together, and but for Wiesbaden and Mainz, we will have the hydrogen out of Energiepark Mainz. So it's really green hydrogen, and we are talking about logistics and things like that.
Well, Energiepark Mainz, of course, because it's the power to gas plant there. The electricity is made by power from the grid,
yes.
and made to green hydrogen. But you also have to see there is a lot of hydrogen already in this big industry parks, which is not used yet.
Yeah, it's not used for traffic applications.
Yeah.
It's used for industrial applications. But it's very clean hydrogen. You have to be aware that you need for hydrogen buses very clean hydrogen. And this is already in a hydrogen which you can use in a pipeline, as is done at the refilling station at the south gate of the plant for traffic.
I know they do that in Cologne, or better to say in Hürth. They have just a pipeline from the industry park and refill their buses there with it.
We have in the industry park, we have only three buses. We have Mr. Vincent Höller, who is a hydrogen fan by heart. He's already using the hydrogen there. Then we have the filling station, and we are hoping that we will use this hydrogen also for the bus fleet in Wiesbaden and the Mainz.
You also mentioned the hydrogen train, which is quite interesting. We showed it here last year on stage, and now it's been a big success story.
Yeah.
I really have to say many countries in Germany have applied it, want to buy it as well, Hessen as well. It's going to run in the Taunus nets.
Yes.
When will that be?
We hope 2022.
2022, all right.
So, very, very soon, because we need the kind of public transportation there, and the cost to electrify the line would be immense, and the train would be a very, very nice experience.
So there are a lot of railways which are not electrified yet.
Yes, yeah.
And they run with diesel normally.
They run with diesel. They are very noisy. And this was a very nice experience riding this train. When you were in the train, when we were in the station, we saw a common diesel train was coming in, and then the hydrogen-driven train. It was, you have 55 decibels. It's like we are talking now. It was very, very nice experience to become very nice. And this is a very wealthy area, so the Taunus train people don't like to have technology from the older days, they would like to have something what is raising their wealthy living style, their lifestyle.
Pastor Shepherd, Rhein-Main area is also Rüsselsheim, and yeah. We know Rüsselsheim, there's a big OEM there. It's now a French OEM, we could say, indeed. So what's coming up there?
Oh, we are happy to hear that they start to become a center for hydrogen and for electric driven cars. So everybody knows that the people there have already some good knowledge about the technology, and the learnings from PSR, Opel, is now that we will see maybe very soon some hydrogen activities also there.
And we have seen already from Opel the Ampera, which is quite a nice car.
A wonderful car,
So we'll see. Maybe one of the 10,000 Dr. Momo is asking for will come from Rüsselsheim then.
We hope so, yeah.
We hope so very much. Okay, but there's more to do. You know, if we think of housing, about heat and energy for houses, there's this micro CHP, we call it, that means combined heat production. So there was one of the first programs in countries in Germany came from Hescher to support this micro CHPs.
I think this is still a success story, and the awareness of this technology in the Hessen region is really high, and the support by our government in regard to this, and now the German government is a big help. But what we see, and I think that's an issue we still have in mind, when if you are bringing a new technology to the people, you have to bring in the people and teach the people and tell them and how they can do it. And my feeling is now, also with stationary systems, you see, you are going to our booth, Fisman is there, and they can tell them that it's a really success story, what they are doing there. And it's very well, the people really like to have this kind of system. And they are, they know it's still a little bit expensive, but they know that they have a technology of the future. And so we have many questions regarding from this, can I do it, and how can I do it, and is it really a clean technology, and.
Pastor Shepherd, is this one discussion rather, a little bit low at the moment, and for my impression, it is when you think about our energy system, the volatile renewable energies, and we also need base load energy, and so therefore we have this big coal plants. The politicians don't want to shut down, but they should. What do you think about fuel cells, stationary fuel cells for base load? Isn't that a good idea in the long run?
Yeah, you see, I think not on a large scale, but I think there are some business cases where we can use the very good performance of fuel cell systems for applications. Like if you're going to a computer hub, very internet hub, there you need a backup, then you can use the electricity, you can use the heat for cooling. We had a very interesting project in Hessen regarding this kind of technology, and what is especially nice there is that you can use the oxygen depleted air as a safety issue against fire hazards. So I think regarding stationary systems, you have to look what is the main the add-on of this technology for the housing whatsoever.
Yeah, that's very interesting, because a fuel cell emits or consumes also air. So if you have a fuel cell in a data center, it takes the air out and
it takes the oxygen out of the air.
Oxygen out of
and
the air.
It leaves an inert gas, so that the fire hazard is reduced. Mm-hmm. We are planning at the moment an hospital where we are sure we can use the heat. We are sure we can use the electricity. And we are going to use it also because we can use the oxygen depleted air for safety reasons, and this is also very strongly supported by the Hessian government.
I would like to open up the floor for you, for your questions. If anybody has a question, just feel free to raise your hand. I'll be with the microphone right with you. What I meant is, in South Korea, they install megawatts of fuel cells there for base load energy, you know, for the just normal grid base load. That's unthinkable in Germany, in Rhine-Main area?
Not really, no. I don't think that's an issue. I think for critical infrastructure, we will have a kind of a system. Mm-hmm. But we have the possibility to use the battery storage systems. We have a very nice grid. If you don't have a grid, then it's a wonderful solution. But as long as we have a grid like the grid is, and it's still a very good one, I think I don't see it. No,
okay. No. Final question. Many people think, well, to get this technology into the market, we need funding. What do you think of funding? Or should we better have business cases for that?
I would like to see business cases, yeah. Because funding, let's place it in the, what I see is that Germany was for a long time in front in the technology. And now you see that Europe is coming, look to Great Britain or France, and then the Asian countries are coming, and they are coming because they have some business cases. And what we need is to see products. I would like to see products, and then I can do the learning curve. But at the moment, my feeling is that we urgently need this kind of outcome. It's not possible to give all the money again and again and again, and then we don't see the output. And if you go to the outside, I'm really a bit disappointed to see not an European car there. That's really a shame. And regarding the bus project, it's very tough to convince the manufacturer to go into this field. So this is why we need regulations.
Maybe it's going to be the startups like Street Scooter and companies like that who will do the big business. Hopefully. And find the business cases. I hope that we really find them, because with funding, the project is over when the funding is over. Yeah. So that's always the problem. Mr. Shepard, now there comes a question. We're just running out of time. Well, let's see. But I would like to take your question, just short question, please, and short answer.
Is there an economic impact for the new hydrogen energy as a general source of energy compared to the environmental? It's just the environmental aspect that's so important, or also economic impact in comparison with the existing energy sources?
Let's open up the whole discussion again. Well, the ecological impact is clear, isn't it? Hydrogen made by renewable energies is green, is emission-free, but this gentleman would like to know a little bit about the economic impact.
I think there would be a big economic impact, because we can start to think in loops. You see, we have green energy. We can have the whole value tree. Still too expensive at the moment, but to start with special cases, we could start to become economic. And in the long run, as soon as we have a really components, serious products, fuel cells, storage systems, I think it will become very economic. You see the decreasing of the costs is like an E-curve. So,
Professor Shepard, it was a pleasure talking to you here on stage. Thank you very much for being here, telling us about zero emission free Rhine-Main area. And thank you very much for joining us here. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And just stay seated, because we will start in a minute our interview with Dr. Joachim Krömer. He's Manager Marketing and Sales of Borit NV, about Factory of the Future for Metal Bipolar Plates and Interconnects. That's going to be very interesting, so just stay tuned for the next interview here on stage. Thank you.